trade away your golden street for a dusty robe, exchange your royalty to wear a sinner's crown, leave your palace and your throne for a cross that's not your own. Let shame replace the mercy you pour out. That's what it takes to be a savior. That's what it takes to be a king. What it means to sacrifice, to redeem and change a life. That's what it takes. That's what it takes to be a savior. In their hands, hear the shouts of those who only mock your name. Feel the sudden sting of death as you draw your final breath, to cry out to a God who's turned away. That's what it takes.
everyone, and welcome to the online services of Ashland Avenue Baptist Church here in Cincinnati, Ohio. I find myself sitting in the foyer of our church with not a lot of movement going on around me. Half the lights are turned off, and the music normally playing and filling the space is turned off as well. The extra parking signs are sitting next to me because, yes, again, we had to cancel services. As disappointing as it is that we can't worship together, we can still worship together through technology and through Facebook and YouTube. And so we're glad that you've chosen to worship with us here at Ashland. Today marks the beginning of a new series called Principles Learned from a Pandemic. And I trust as we study God's Word together that as we navigate the changes that we're experiencing, that we can still find hope and we can still find comfort in who God is. And so we're going to be in Psalm 61. Would you turn on or grab your Bibles and join with me as we study this Psalm of David? And let's find encouragement as we look for principles that we can learn in a pandemic. Psalm 61 is where we're going to be. Let's look at the first four verses together. And I want to begin this morning a series of messages on principles learned during a pandemic. And I trust that now that we have kind of been self-quarantined for a week or maybe a little bit more than a week, we have found ourselves really starting to feel, probably not even to full effect, we're starting to feel some effects of limiting social engagement, of some of the financial hardships that might be around the corner. And so I trust as we go through this that we will find great encouragement from God's Word, because I'm going to be honest with you, aside from the Word of God, I'm not sure how else we can provide hope and share encouraging thoughts apart from what God has laid out for us already. Can't really share a how-to message because guess what? I've never been through a situation like this, and I certainly have never pastored through a pandemic. And so all of the encouraging messages that you have sent both to myself and to my wife, know that those are appreciated. Your prayers are appreciated. We want to do what is right for our church, but we are anxious about getting back together and continuing to move forward with the ministry that God has given to us here at Ashland. So please be in prayer about this, and let's not take this lightly. Let's stay connected together as a local body of believers, and let's continue to find ways to serve God through a unique set of circumstances that we find ourselves in. We're in Psalm 61. We're going to begin in verse number one reading. We'll go down to verse number four, and we're going to spend the bulk of our time together there, but we're going to wrap up in verse number eight. Here's what Psalm 61, verse one says. Hear my cry, O God, and attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For thou hast been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy. Can we stop and think about what David is sharing here in Psalm 61? I heard a story about a certain little boy who greatly missed his father. The two had been separated for quite some time because of the father's involvement in the military. And the boy found great comfort, though, in a picture that his mom had provided in a frame. And as is common with a child, he would sometimes wake up at night frightened by the dark, or maybe a closet door was propped open that he wasn't comfortable with. And instead of crying out for mom to run in, a simple glimpse over towards that nightstand would provide comfort and would provide peace to that little boy as he sees an image of his dad. The little boy liked to explain that when he sees his dad, he liked to pretend that he was being watched over by his dad until one point where that pretending no longer worked. Waking up and being frightened by the dark, he lets out a squeal that grabs the attention from another room of his mother, and his mom comes rushing into the room and asks her son, what's wrong? And he explains to her how he was afraid of the dark, and she said, well, don't you look at the picture? And he said, yeah, I looked at the picture as I have time after time again. But this time was different. The response of the little boy through tears to his mom was this. This time, I just want daddy to jump out of the frame. There's something about that closeness. There is something about that personal touch, that having dad in the room physically there, that was so different than having him confined into that frame. Let me ask you this morning, has that ever been your experience in life? Let's dig a little bit deeper and let's get a little bit more personal this morning. Is this a good explanation of the experience that you're having in life right now? Perhaps you even know that God is real.
Maybe you know that God describes himself as a God of love. Maybe you know and you've repeated the phrase that God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. And we share these sayings and we exchange verses back and forth to try to encourage each other. But have you ever gotten to the point where things had become so bleak and so challenging and oftentimes simply disheartening that it feels like God is packaged in just a little frame? And wouldn't it be nice if he would just remove himself from that frame and show himself real to you, maybe just once? You know, I wonder if that's where we find ourselves today. We are living in a wildly unique set of circumstances with this COVID-19 virus that's been floating around. And we find ourselves now, at least as we count Sundays, this is the second Sunday, as we are trying to adhere to the guidelines that are handed down to us by the authorities. And the authorities have called us to this phrase. They have encouraged us to shelter in place. And we understand that the powers that be are there because they are ordained by God, and they have their power because God gave it to them. And so we want to be as respectful as possible, not just to our authorities, but because we are concerned about the health of one another. So here we are, probably sitting on a couch, maybe not even rolled out of bed yet, watching on a tablet or a screen of some sort, studying God's word together. But we also do so knowing that this shelter in place has really thrown a monkey wrench into all of our lives. Things are totally different. You know, for a lot of us, there might be a lot of first-time instances that we are experiencing because of this shelter-in-place acknowledgement or recommendation, I say. Wonder if this is the first time we've ever stayed home from the office. Maybe you've been blessed and you're able to work from home and still receive a paycheck. Maybe you're remotely dialed in to your computer at work and you're able to converse with people at work or get your work done. That's a blessing. But to stay home in the mornings and not commute, that's been a major alteration of your routine. Maybe this is the first time you've had to work a ton more hours simply because you're trying to keep ships afloat. The responsibilities that have been delegated to you have now increased because of the decrease of manpower in that company. And now you find yourself working 15, 18, 20 hours a day, just trying to make it through this virus until hopefully it's able to dissipate and we're able to return to life somewhat as normal. But you find yourself exhausted right now. Maybe 9:30 for a Sunday morning Bible study is just too early because you're wiped out. You were up late even last night trying to knock out some of the to-do lists that you have to do. And if not job or career related, maybe your family demands have increased as well. Maybe this is the first time that you have had no idea where the next paycheck is going to come from. And as a result, it might be your first time having to file for unemployment. It stresses you out. It's a burden that we have to carry. Maybe this is the first time attempting a version of homeschooling and you are finding yourselves a little more appreciative of those teachers that deal with our children day in and day out faithfully and with patience. And maybe you're at the point now where you're thinking, I can't wait for the virus to pass because I don't know that we're cut out for this homeschooling scene. Maybe you are a homeschooler and you're thinking it's about time people realize what we deal with. I don't know. But this is a first for many. Maybe this is the first time navigating the rough waters of communicating with those children concerning why they can't go to the park and why we have to stay home. And you're sharing with them a delicate matter of information, not wanting to scare them or to overreact, but being a good parent, you want to protect them and guard them from a sickness that could wreak havoc on their bodies. You know, there are a lot of first times that we are experiencing together, but not together, if that makes sense. However, with those firsts also come many different pre-existing conditions that are now being emphasized because of the different lifestyles that we are having to live. Maybe those who are living paycheck to paycheck are simply just now living and trying to figure out how not to lose our homes. Maybe we are scared that our mortgage payments are going to potentially go into default and there's a chance that we lose our home. Maybe we've already lost the income. Maybe our businesses have shut down and we're sitting at home twiddling our thumbs. And listen, there is one thing that is true about all of this, regardless of your employment status, that the changes that we have experienced over the past week, and I am scared to say it, but I think it's relatively true, that in weeks to come, the changes that we are experiencing are going to produce a lot of stress, increased burden, and man, sometimes it's just going to become overwhelming at times. You know, these lists that I gave you could go on and on. However, the point being, the effects of the shelter in place are starting to be felt, but the effectiveness of shelter in place has yet to be seen. For many of us, it's the loss of control that we can't handle. We like thinking that we have this all mapped out and that Monday to Friday we have our 9-to-5 jobs and we have a steady flow of income, and it takes out the guessing game that we're having to wrestle with. And when you lose that control, it causes you to lose your hair. And that combined with simply just not knowing how long this is going to take, not knowing if life is going to actually resume as we used to know it, or are things going to be permanently different, not knowing if when we are allowed to cease the shelter in home or shelter in place reference, that's not a right phrase, but not knowing if we're able to go back out and to get another job quickly to generate the income that we've missed. You know, I think, again, that we can all agree that there right now is an increase maybe of anxiety. Let me ask you something. Does the increased stress also increase the number of outbursts that you're having at home? Maybe not even verbal, but maybe it causes you to recoil into isolation, because that's sometimes how some deal with stress. And so if you're not verbally just getting angry at people and getting short with people, maybe you have really just backed off and detached yourself from other people because of the loss of control and the lack of knowledge of the future, and it's stressing you out. Are you experiencing a loss of confidence and just an overall general sense of a loss of hope? Is that you this morning? Because I know this much based on what I'm hearing, reading, and in conversations that I have, that there are a lot of hurting people already right now, and it's heartbreaking. And I told you, I wish that we can, and maybe somebody better than I could sit down and share with you step by step how it is that we can survive this thing, because we can look on past instances and see this is what we did that succeeded, this is what we did that failed. But unfortunately, as we look through the lens of history, we don't have much to compare this to. So what we do want to do this morning is to go to Psalm 61 and find those instances where maybe a biblical character finds themselves in duress like you and I do, and see how it is that they were able to make it through those situations and how. Because isn't the best how-to method found not by studying a book or getting a digital copy of a book even, but by studying God's Word? And so in Psalm 61, what we find is King David is sitting literally in a same type of boat as you and I are. We catch David now mourning over the loss of his son Absalom. If you remember in your biblical history, in your Old Testament history, Absalom had led a revolt against his own dad, David. During that revolt, David's military leader by the name of Joab was able to kill Absalom. And in the process, David then knew his control over the situation was totally gone. Listen, he had done it once and would have been willing to do it again. I promise you, because David was a man after God's own heart, that David's heart was, I want to reconcile the relationship with my child. Unfortunately, though, he had no control over the situation because Absalom was gone. And maybe that loss of hope of ever making it right for reconciling that relationship was just as gone as Absalom was. So David sits down and he pens this short psalm with the backdrop of having lost his child. He has no control over the situation. The followers of Absalom are probably going to be pursuing David at any time. And maybe he's experiencing having not been able even to go home. Maybe he's in a place of a loss of hope as well. And so in the first two verses of Psalm 61, I want you to see this. David makes a request from God. Now, David is a very emotional person. If you read through the Psalms, you notice and you can sense the roller coaster that David oftentimes finds himself in. Psalm 61, in just the 8 verses that we have here, show us in literally 8 verses the ups and downs that David experienced. But in this instance, where again, control is gone, hope is lost, he makes a request of God. And his first request is found right in verse number 1. And the request simply is this: God, would you just hear me? Please just listen. You know, the idea there, it says, hear my cry, O God. That's his request. It's a piercing scream, a ringing cry. Oftentimes, this word cry was used attached to celebratory cries, screams of excitement and joy. But in this context, it would be a similar volume level or a piercing scream, but originating from a person who is experiencing absolute heartbreak. David was terribly sincere as he shouted to God in anguish. In this, you find a sense of urgency as well. Listen, David wasn't content, and David wasn't just happy with being able to vent to God. And as we like to say it, he was not satisfied with just getting something off of his chest. He desperately wanted to bend the ear of the Lord his direction. Because listen, here's one thing. In a time of hope, and a time of despair, and a time of exhaustion or being overwhelmed, David knew. He knew exactly what it was that he needed, and he needed God to listen to him. Can I give you 3 statements regarding prayer? Maybe it's been a while since you got on your knees or simply just bowed your head and asked God, Lord, would you please just listen to me? Would you please just take into consideration what I'm going through? So let me give you 3 statements regarding prayer that might help kickstart your prayer life again. The first statement is this, and you notice this in our text here, that prayer is not all about saying the right words. You know, often we think because we hear people in church pray and we hear phrases that are tossed around, and we think maybe our prayers are more effective when we put together the right string of words. And maybe I need to use big theological terms, and maybe I need to use a similar prayer that I heard a more godly person per se use, and so we repeat what we've heard. But I want to tell you this, when it comes to communication with God, there are no magical formulas to bend the ear of God your direction. There are no right words per se. Sometimes, as in the case of David, he's just crying out and he's screaming to God, and sometimes we don't even know what the right words are to say. And so you understand my point that David is proving to us here is that it does not have to be a magical formula of words that we string together into sentences that gets God's attention. Listen, it's not about saying the right words. If you have not spent time in prayer with God, you can sit down, you can bow your head and close your eyes, and you can pray in sincerity and authenticity, and you can be real with your God and have conversation with him and use terminology because he understands. And so it's not all about saying the right words, it's about getting the right ear. See, this piercing cry was David's distress signal to God. It was the only thing he could think to activate in his life that might grab and bend the ear of God towards him, not just saying a particular set of words. Here's thought number 2 regarding our prayers. A praying breath is never spent in vain. You know, I understand that there's a lot of bickering back and forth and a lot of discussion as to whether our government made the right decisions, whether they were proactive enough to be able to minimize the effects of this virus. I understand that there's different opinions regarding how churches are handling these things. And we can fight back and forth and we can express opinions until we're blue in the face. But here's one thing that I want us to understand about a pandemic right now. And that is, as God has literally slowed down the speed of our lives, there has never been a better time for you and I to develop more deeply our prayer life than now. You know, instead of hopping on and going back and forth with people, either on a text message or a phone call or on social media, whatever the means might be that we find ourselves engaging others in debate with, what if we set aside that same amount of time and we just made our prayers be known to God? Lord, would you use this situation that we find ourselves in to your glory? And we know that he can. God, would you use this situation to draw people closer to yourself? Because again, as some have pointed out, think about it. Everything that we like to invest our lives into have been stripped away at this point. Outside of really our family and a limited number of people's careers, the things that we find ourselves so involved in have been literally stopped, canceled, postponed, or totally removed from our lives. Listen, we've lost sports. We've lost, for a lot of us, our careers. We don't have a lot of income, so we're probably not going out to eat, or at least going through a drive-thru a whole lot, because paying the mortgage payment next month is more important than going out to eat, and we'll just eat what we have on the shelves at home. And again, that list could easily be expounded a little bit more, but the point being is, all of those things that we used to spend a ton of time involved in, where are they now? So what if, instead of wasting our breath trying to argue with people about right, wrongs, and opinions, what if we spent that amount of time honestly pleading with God that he would meet our needs, that he would provide health, that he would guard your church, regardless of where that might be, that he would protect and give wisdom to the leadership that we are so quick to criticize, both in our nation and in our churches? Because listen, there are a lot of different breaths that go into vanity and that are spent in vain. But a praying breath is never in vain. I think we have been provided a sincere opportunity to remember the value and to put into practice prayer. So prayer isn't all about saying the right words. It's about getting the right ear. And a praying breath is never in vain. Here's the third thought. God should always be our first thought, not our last resort. And I did steal that one from Adrian Rogers, and it's a great statement. God should be our first thought, not our last resort. And so David's request here was simply this: God, would you hear me? Lord, would you show yourself real? Hey, can I ask you something? In all of this chaos that has ensued, have you seen God at all through any of this? Have you noticed him at work at all because of the change of your world? If not, we need to be looking with a fine-tooth comb and find God at work in all of this. God, would you hear me? There's his first request. But then you look into verse number 2 and you hear the second one. First, God, would you hear me? Second, God, would you help me? Look at verse 2. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. So David now finds himself in a position where his heart is totally overwhelmed, nearly to the point of sheer exhaustion and absolute fainting. David was away from home. His routine was destroyed. His son was dead. His heart was defeated. And honestly, we all get there at one point or another. And again, my fear is, and maybe not today, maybe we need to share this video if this drags on out into more weeks. And we need to remind ourselves of this. But listen, when we get to a point where everything is defeated and we are exhausted and we get to that point where our circumstances are no longer a joke, how we react to those circumstances, that's not a joke either. And David's thought here in verse number 2 is, when it seems like all hope is lost and my heart is faint, my cry is always going to be directed back to you, God. I need you to hear me and I need you to help me. And listen, I promise you this, someone right now who is watching this video is right in that point of saying, God, I've got to have your help. I don't know where the next meal is going to come from, and I don't know who's going to pay my mortgage, but I do know that you can provide. God, listen to me and please help. Why can we call to God? You find the answer in the second part of verse number 2, and you find that answer is simply this. We can cry out to God for our help because He is our rock. 22 times in the book of Psalms, we find God referred to as the rock. You know, and David contrasts himself with God as this much, as David is acknowledging that he is a frail human being and that God is sufficient. And so while it felt like he was drowning in a sea of heartbreak and a loss of hope and a loss of control, and his heart was overwhelmed, and it seemed like the waters were literally beating him to death, he knew this much. He needed to be able to elevate himself to a rock, to a position of safety that was higher than where he was now. Because think about it. If the rock was going to be on level ground of where he was, sure, he could climb up and maybe keep his head above water. But what happens when the next wave comes? It's going to knock him right off. You see, David's attention was to get to higher ground, a position of safety and security. It was a position of trust and the protection that that rock provided. And that rock for you and I is none other than God Himself. See, Psalms refers to God as the rock, and in this instance, He is a source of stability. It's a stability that is worth focusing on because we are watching right now waves crash all around us. And if you remember, maybe this brings to your mind the instance of Peter stepping out of the boat and being able to walk across water. And when he takes his eyes off of Christ, he begins to sink and he begins to drown. And he cries out, what? Lord, would you help me? Is that not what David's doing right now? He's reminding us, first of all, God, would you hear me? Because I'm crying out to you in prayer. And God, would you help me? Because the waves are absolutely punishing me and I am overwhelmed. And if you've ever been like in a pool or you've ever been caught in an undertow in the ocean, you know it seems like the longer you swim and the longer you tread water, that it becomes exhausting. And that's where David is literally at in his life, a point of exhaustion, and he doesn't know which way to turn except for up. And so he looks for a rock that is literally higher than he is to provide that stability and safety and protection that he needs at this time. And listen, this is the exact cry that we should be repeating right now when we find ourselves in a position of hurt because of the virus that's been spread. So God is given a request by David. Would you hear me? Would you help me? Hey, listen. You find yourself struggling right now? Why not reinstitute a prayer life, not of magical words, but maybe just of two simple pleads? God, would you hear me? Would you help me? Then you get to verse number 3, and you find David's refuge. Verse number 3 says this, "For thou hast been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy." So now he starts to realize that his requests of, God, would you lead me to a rock that is higher than I? God is doing exactly as David requested. He is directing, he is leading the attention back to the rock of the book of Psalms. And that rock is God Himself. And as David's attention begins to shift away from the circumstances of the loss of control and the loss of hope and the loss of his son, his mind is now redirected to that true higher rock. And it reminds him of the answer to the question of why. Why can I trust God? Why can I turn to God and cry out for Him? And David gives two answers. He said, first of all, I know that you're a rock higher than I because, in verse number 3, you are my shelter. And so we understand that a place of sheltering, as it is applied by our local authorities and those doctors who are recommending that we stay in place, we understand that that is a call of protection. That a shelter in place order is given to us to protect us from either contracting a virus ourselves or becoming a carrier of that virus to someone else that it could adversely affect. But when you think about it this way, in David's perspective, as he refers to the rock of the book of Psalms, especially the 61st Psalm, David understands that God is our ultimate shelter. He is a place of hope. He is a place of refuge. He is a place of trust. Now let's think about that word refuge there. In the Old Testament, a refuge, especially as we dub them a city of refuge, was a safe house where a person could flee from enemies who were pursuing them, and that person can find safety inside of that refuge. And David identifies God as being that place of safety. If you remember in Psalm 46, verse 1, David says, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Notice the tense that David uses, though, in verse number 3. For thou hast been. Now think about that. When we use the phrase, thou hast been, we are thinking in the past. We are starting from the present, and we're working our way backwards. Now remember, David's cry in verse number 2. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And God is doing exactly that. He is leading David into kind of a personal history lesson. And David is now realizing that, yeah, matters are pretty bad right now. And you might be neck deep in concerns and feeling extremely overwhelmed. But God has now taken David on this history lesson where he is reminding David that I have always been in past experience faithfully providing help and shelter to you, David. Never turn my back on you. Someone said this, from the past, we gather arguments for the present. Now, I want us to stop and think about that because, again, not knowing the extremity of the situation for everyone that watches a video, I don't know the express issues that you are dealing with personally or as a family. But I do know this, we are in a time that can seem extremely overwhelming. Can you take just a quick history lesson and remember times where God has proven himself faithful in your life? Can you remember times where God is taking care of you, and maybe when you're in the midst of that struggle, you didn't recognize it? But now that you're able to look back on it, and hindsight being what it is, it's 2020, we can see those little pieces of God moving. Maybe when we were blinded at the time, but being able to look back on it, we can identify. Hey, you want to share one thing, and this is kind of what Israel did in their relationship with God. You want to share one thing with your children that might be good, parents? Share with them one time that God proved himself faithful. Share with them hope and encouragement that can be found in a relationship with God, even when they can't go to a playground or enjoy the weather that we've had for the past couple days. Here's a good practice. Reflect on God's goodness to us and reflect on his faithfulness to provide and protect. Listen, even when our heart is overwhelmed, our God isn't. And he can be our shelter, he can be our refuge, and I'll tell you this, he wants to be your place of hope. He's a shelter. That's why he's a rock that's higher than we are. But then he says also, God is a strong tower. Now, a strong tower was also a type of refuge, but with a difference when compared to the shelter. Remember, a shelter was that place of safety to run when the enemies were pursuing. But what happens when you need safety when the enemy is already attacking? Well, that's the aspect of the strong tower. Think about a fortified city. In the biblical times, they would build walls to protect that city. And on the walls, they would build these towers where a watchman would sit. And as that watchman kept guard over the city, when the enemy attacked, the strong tower then turns into a battle station where they could reach the enemy, but the enemy couldn't reach them. You see, God is a safe place to hide. He's our shelter, but God is also our strong tower in that He is a safe place to fight. And listen, if there is anything right now that is worth fighting for, fight for your family, fight for unity, and fight for your prayer time, and fight for fellow believers. And I'll tell you this, fight for opportunities to continue to serve, because the enemy, our adversary, the devil, would love nothing than to see these weeks, and maybe the weeks to come in the future, be used to destroy Christianity and to destroy our efforts for the kingdom of God. We have to fight for them. And so sure, God is our shelter. He is a wonderful place of protection and safety and a great place to hide. But sometimes we need that strong tower. It is time to fight our enemy. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you are fighting in your mind over the exhaustion and the discouragement and depression and the questioning that is constantly popping up, here is what we have to do. God, would you hear me and would you help me? Because I'm tired of fighting in here, but I'm giving this battle over to you as my strong tower. And God, I'm asking you to fight on my behalf. Because honestly, I'm tired and I don't know that I can go on anymore right now. I need some rest. And so the request was, would you hear me and would you help me? And as my rock, I know you can because you're my shelter and you're my strong tower, which gets us now to verse number 4. Watch the dramatic shift of the emotions of David. This is amazing. Look at verse 4. And so he says, I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the covert of thy wings. So here we have David now giving his response, and he makes two I will statements. I will abide. He wanted to remain in the tabernacle, which was the location of the presence of God, because David knew the best place to go when I'm struggling and overwhelmed is straight into the presence of God. God, I'm going to abide here. I want to stay here. And then he says also then in verse 4, I will trust. And I want you to think about this picture as a baby bird. Trust the care that is provided by his parent as he hovers over them and he protects them with the wings of that parental bird. That is the image that we have in verse number 4. The God with his wings, per se, provides comfort. And I'll tell you this, he provides protection and he does not turn away any that choose to seek him. So watch what happens. We gain a proper perspective of God, and we cry out to him for him to hear us and help us. So then you look at verse number 5 and what happens. Isn't this great? Watch the shift in the attitude and the emotions of David. He goes from exhaustion and being overwhelmed and pleading for God simply to hear. And then in verse number 5, what does he recognize? For thou, O God, hast heard me. You've heard my prayer. My screams, yeah, they were not in vain. The shedding of the tears and the anguish and the hurt that I have been pouring out to you did not fall on a deaf ear. See, David now has transitioned from hopelessness in verse number 1 to hopefulness in verse number 5. And you can almost see the change of David's demeanor right in black and white on the pages of God's word. He goes from sincerely pleading now to verse number 8 where he is singing praises. What an amazing thought. So what is the principle that we need to learn? Again, I don't know how to do a how-to in this because I've never been through a pandemic. But what I do know by studying He who is attributed the title of a man after God's own heart, that he may not have been dealing with a pandemic globally with a virus like we are, but he was dealing with an epidemic of his heart that was overwhelmed from all of the loss he was experiencing. Here is the lesson that we learn. And that is that while the world may call for us to shelter in place, God has called us to shelter in a person. And that person is the rock in Psalm 61, and that rock is God. Listen, if you are going to get your head above water and you want to have victory over the overwhelming sensation of loss and discouragement and what other else trait that you're dealing with right now, here's how you do it. The principle of a pandemic is shelter in a person, not in a place. See, focusing on a place focuses on our circumstances, and that will eat us alive. But when we focus on the person of God, He will provide hope because He is our shelter and our strong tower. And so my encouragement for you this morning is super simple. Go back to verse number 1. If you're still in that discouraging time, you're in the first 4 verses of Psalm 61. Renew your relationship with God through prayer. Call out to Him and trust Him as your rock and tell Him how deep you are in concerns and ask Him, God, would you lead me to a place, to a rock that's higher than I? Because again, I'm to a point where I cannot go on by myself. I need you as the sufficient protector and provider. I need you as my God. And then I trust as you begin to lean on Him fully. And as you express your heart before God, He's going to take you down a walk, down memory lane. He's going to remind you of instances in the past where maybe when you were in the trenches, it didn't feel like God was there. But He's going to start to show you very quickly how it is that He's always been faithful and how it is that He's always provided, He's always protected. And when He begins to walk you down memory lane, you're going to get to verse number 8. Watch this. This is David. This is the same David that in verse number 1 was pleading and crying out with a piercing voice before God. Look at verse number 8. So will I sing praise unto thy name forever, that I may daily perform my vows. Isn't that where we want to get to today? Don't we want to get to a point where we are singing the praises of God instead of dealing with the burdens that we can cast on Him? Listen, cry out to God. Watch Him meet those needs. Yeah, this might be a time that stretches you and challenges you, but I promise you this, when all is said and done, your prayer life and your faith will be strengthened because you stopped trusting in your ability to fix everything and you started trusting in your ability to trust God to take care of what He has promised to provide for and protect. Be careful. When God proves Himself real and He jumps out of that frame for you, be careful that your relationship with Him at that point doesn't stop, but that you go into the season of singing praises because of who He is and what He's done on your behalf. Father, I pray for each one that has opportunity to listen to this study. Lord, I pray that You would jump out of the frame. God, there are many right now that need to know that You're there. God, we tell each other, God's good, He's got this. I've used those same phrases with folks, and it's not that we don't believe it. It's that right now where we are, and out of fear of losing control over situations and out of fear of losing a house or losing income, God, it seems like right now we are in a season of loss. And we know You're good. We know You're real. We know You love us. But God, right now, where we are in this moment, we just need You to hear us and to help us. So God, I pray for those that are carrying massive burdens, that have had to shut down businesses, that are losing income, coming off the road where they are using their giftedness for You. God, where there are churches that are financially struggling, and if this continues to drag on much longer, could have potentially irreversible effects on their income and on their survival. But God, in all of this loss, may the kingdom of God experience great gain because believers cry out to You and we find continual ways to serve others for the increase of Your kingdom in the times of a loss in our own lives. God, may we find hope. May we find stability. May we find encouragement as we ask You to lead us to the rock that is higher than I, and You lift us up out of the waves that are crashing into us and hurting us so bad, and You provide the peace and comfort that we've been looking for. God, help us to remember this simple principle during a pandemic, that, Father, we are supposed to shelter in a person, not in a place. And may we shelter in the person of God. We give you the thanks for it, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
The principle today that God is driving home is that we shelter in a person, not in a place. Aren't you thankful for who God is? Be thankful for the fact that we can cry out to Him, even when it seems like He's still in that picture frame, and when we desperately want Him to just jump out and prove Himself real. All we have to do is rewind in our memories, and we can pinpoint instances of faithfulness where God has proven Himself to be real and good to us time and time again. If you're overwhelmed today, if you're struggling, if there's anything that we can do to help you beyond sharing with you God's Word, please take a moment and message us here in Facebook. We'd love to converse with you and see if there's anything we can do to either serve you or your family as well. If you're joining with us as a visitor, we want to encourage you to come back and visit our site again. You can also go back in the archives here on Facebook. You can visit ashlandavenue.org and see some of the studies that we've had preceding this one. And maybe even there you can find hope and encouragement through the studies that we have had before this also. If you call Ashland your home or you're faithfully fed here, let me encourage you also to worship through giving. I'm thankful for the faithfulness of God's people. I'm thankful for the checks that we've received in the mail. And now at ashlandavenue.org, we can also give online, and we can establish some reoccurring gifts just so we don't miss a beat. And so we know that the ministry of God's Word must continue, that God can use an instance like this to increase His kingdom. And all of that is hinging on the faithfulness of God's people to give. If you'd like to text to give, you can text the word Ashland Give to the number 77977, and through the prompts that you will receive on your phone, you can give online in that form as well. Again, we want to say thank you for joining us. We're looking forward to worshiping back together and celebrating when all of this stuff is done. But may God prove Himself to be your rock, to be your shelter, and to be the strong tower that you need during this time of hurt, during this time of loss of control, and during this time of just feeling overwhelmed. May God use His Word and His Holy Spirit to encourage you. And until next time, know that we love you and we're praying for you and we're here to serve you however way we can. God bless you, and we'll talk to you soon.